Hulu's new stop-motion animated show MODOK absolutely delights in the use of obscure Marvel Comics characters. If you're new to the bizarre world of MODOK, here's what these characters are all about. While you may not have heard of him before now, the hovering, big-headed super genius MODOK has been a part of Marvel Comics since 1967's Tales of Suspense, issue 94. He was originally a Captain America villain, but doesn't really belong to the rogues gallery of any one hero. From the very beginning, MODOK has been associated with a group of evil scientists and weapons dealers called Advanced Idea Mechanics, or AIM, which was brought into the Marvel Cinematic Universe in Iron Man 3.
Advanced Idea Mechanics, or AIM. For sure, do you get it?
I see that because it's on your t-shirt.
Of course, it should be noted that the MODOK currently hovering around in Marvel Comics, including the 4-issue 2020 miniseries Head Games penned by MODOK creators Patton Oswalt and Jordan Bloom, which lays the groundwork for much of the show, isn't technically the original MODOK. That MODOK was changed back into his original human form, George Tarleton, during the World War Hulks event in 2010. The new MODOK, dubbed MODOK Superior, is a cloned version, but nonetheless possesses Tarleton's memories. In MODOK, the Super-Adaptoid is the comic relief character in the MODOK family, half inept butler and half annoying pet. As a result, it might surprise viewers to learn that the Adaptoid not only predates MODOK himself by a full year in Marvel Comics history, but was also a supervillain to be taken seriously. While the Hulu version seems to be just a shapeshifter and imitator, the Adaptoid in the comics could also appropriate someone else's superpowers, or even multiple sets of superpowers at the same time. It was powered by the Cosmic Cube, the comic book inspiration for the Tesseract in the MCU, and was a regular opponent of the Avengers, at one point becoming almost omnipotent before being defeated by Captain America. The Adaptoid has been used semi-regularly in the comics since then, and there have proven to be multiple versions. This plot point comes up in Head Games, which reveals that AIM's founder and MODOK's original father has an entire army of Super-Adaptoids hidden away in a small town in Ohio. Another character closely associated with AIM, Monica Rappaccini, is a villainous scientist specializing in biochemistry. The show initially depicts her as MODOK's primary underling before the two of them engage in a heated rivalry over who will be scientist supreme in the new AIM, a conflict that puts a hilariously mundane spin on their relationship in the comics. Since her first appearance in 2005, Monica has almost always been MODOK's direct enemy, constantly battling him for control of both AIM and the title of scientist supreme. While MODOK often gets the better of her in the comics, the show portrays her as being his clear superior in both science and villainy. Perhaps more interesting than Monica, however, is her daughter Carmilla, who makes a couple brief appearances in MODOK. While she didn't do much in Season 1, the scorpion design on her shirt is a reference to the fact that in the comics, Carmilla is a superhero and SHIELD agent known as Scorpion, who has powers of toxicity provided by her mother's genetic experimentation. Simon Williams, aka Wonder Man, has one of the most bizarre narrative histories in Marvel Comics. First appearing in Avengers issue 9 in 1964, he is given superpowers in order to fight the Avengers by the evil Baron Zemo, but ends up turning against Zemo to save the Avengers instead. Unfortunately, he also dies in the process, making him the rare character with decades worth of continuity despite the fact that he didn't live through his debut issue. This is made possible both by the fact that his brainwaves were copied by Iron Man and ultimately used to create the Vision, and the fact that his body wasn't actually dead, and would be revived multiple times before he finally officially joined the Avengers. Wonder Man is an interesting choice of Avenger for MODOK to use even in a limited capacity. He is famously conflicted about being an Avenger, often wondering if the team actually does any good, and at one point leaving to become an actor. He would later openly lament his time with the Avengers and even form his own team to actively oppose them. The fourth episode of MODOK sees the title character team up with five other low-level villains, who then show up sporadically for the rest of the season. Probably the most notable is Armadillo, who, unlike the others, has comic book ties to MODOK. In MODOK, Armadillo is seen obsessing over his ex-wife, a reference to his comic book origins. He allowed the criminal scientist Carlin Malice to experiment on him, mixing his genes with those of an armadillo, if Malice could cure his wife's illness. Malice did so, but Armadillo would later go on a rampage after discovering she was cheating on him, and he's been involved in various small-time villain shenanigans ever since. He was also a member of the Unlimited Class Wrestling Federation, a superhuman wrestling promotion. And most importantly, he was a member of the so-called MODOK's 11, a heist crew put together by MODOK to steal a device called the Hypernova. Armadillo was one of the few members of the team who didn't betray MODOK. Another representative of the Unlimited Class Wrestling Federation is Poundcakes. Originally a member of a four-woman wrestling team called the Grapplers, who came into conflict with the Thing, Poundcakes would later be given superhuman strength and durability by the Power Broker Corporation, a company that offers superpowers for the right price. It was co-founded by the same Carlin Malice that gave Armadillo his powers. If we get MODOK Season 2, it would be fun to see the other three members of the Grapplers, particularly Screaming Mimi, who had a lengthy career as a villain before adopting the name Songbird and eventually joining the Avengers. Another connection to Screaming Mimi exists in the form of Angar the Screamer. Beginning his existence as essentially an evil hippie in the pages of Daredevil, Angar has sonic powers that he uses to cause hallucinations in the minds of others. Though in MODOK, his abilities appear to be more of the standard sonic scream used by characters like Banshee and Siren. He has some tangential connections to previous Marvel adaptations. He got his powers as part of a scheme to fight Thanos, but his most notable connection is his long-standing criminal partnership with Screaming Mimi. Angar's death would be the catalyst for Mimi rechristening herself Songbird and eventually becoming a superhero, even killing Angar again when he returned as a being of solid sound known as Scream. Okay, so Meltzer dies at the end of MODOK Episode 4, with MODOK's insistence that they were best friends coming up on several occasions. But he's still an instructive character when it comes to initiating where MODOK might go next. Several of the characters we've looked at so far have been associated in some capacity with a group called the Masters of Evil, led by Baron Zemo. Meltzer is an original member of the Masters of Evil, and his presence might be the strongest clue in favor of something resembling that group showing up in Season 2 of MODOK. He's also, appropriately, the oldest character on this list, dating back to 1963, when he was introduced as an Iron Man villain due to his dastardly ability to melt iron. Last, and certainly least of MODOK's team, Tenpin is an extraordinarily obscure Marvel Comics character who is a member of a villainous team called the Death Throes. Yes, really. A dubious brainchild of an evil juggler named the Ringleader, the Death Throes are, in fact, entirely composed of evil jugglers, including Bombshell, Knick-Knack, and Tenpin's brother, Oddball. Tenpin naturally uses bowling pins as weapons, though in the comics they don't explode. It might seem strange to even mention Tenpin on this list, but to be honest, in a show like MODOK, is it really more likely to see characters or comics take seriously, or characters that are already a ready-made joke? You laugh now, but you'll thank us when MODOK encounters a group of nefarious circus performers in Season 2, and you get to tell your friends what their names are. Tenpin might be a silly character, but when it comes to Marvel villain silliness involving sinister gameplay, there's nobody quite as wonderfully dumb as Arcade. Originally created in 1978, Arcade is a genius inventor who also happens to be thoroughly insane, and applies his considerable intelligence to the creation of elaborate death traps for superheroes, which they, of course, always escape. For fans of Marvel Comics, his appearance in MODOK is one of the highlights of the show, as the script hits us with one joke after another, running down his ridiculous idiosyncrasies and self-sabotaging schemes. As an assassin who never manages to kill his targets because he insists on following the rules of his bizarre games, he has, until now, been an untapped well of Marvel adaptation comedy.
I took the liberty of adding two more MODOKs because I am freaking cuckoo for symmetry and I have got to have it!
Of all the all-but-unknown characters used in MODOK, none are quite as obscure as Hexus, the Living Corporation. While the show's primary antagonist is a time-traveling version of MODOK himself, Hexus serves as a capable secondary villain, serving as a shadowy board of the company that purchases AIM. It's a sensible decision considering the modern themes of corporate acquisition and startup culture that MODOK plays with, but it's also a staggeringly deep pull. In order to know who Hexus is in the Marvel comics, you would have had to have read a single issue of Marvel Boy from October 2000, in which the series' Kree protagonist, Nova, must take down the swarming alien corporation before it consumes Earth. Written by the acclaimed Grant Morrison, Marvel Boy Issue 3 provides a scathing critique of corporate capitalism by equating standard corporate activity with a plot to actively destroy the world. Ironically, by the time Nova fights it, Hexus is already threatening to topple Disney. In light of this critique, it is perhaps unsurprising that Hexus has never been revisited in the pages of Marvel Comics, and unless Nova himself is going to make an appearance, there's not much speculation to be drawn from its presence in MODOK. What the inclusion of Hexus does tell us, however, is that there's no character too small for MODOK to unearth and use as a part of its narrative. If Hexus, the Living Corporation, can show up, anyone can.
The board is pleased!
At first glance, there's no indication that MODOK's wife and children have roots anywhere in the comics. Comic book MODOK is not a bumbling loser in the grip of a midlife crisis. He is a twisted, deformed villain, and he certainly never had anything resembling a human family. That is, of course, until 2020's Head Games, in which Oswalt and Bloom took the opportunity Marvel had handed them in the form of writing a MODOK miniseries to introduce Jodie, Melissa, and Lou prior to the release of the MODOK show. Of course, in Head Games, MODOK's family isn't real, his memories of them are simulated, part of a plan by his father. But by the end of the story, MODOK has defeated his father and used three members of AIM's army of Super-Adaptoids to create real versions of the family, which then join forces with him to bring down his enemies. What could this tell us about Season 2? Well, considering the show ends with MODOK having sacrificed his family in order to realize his dream of world conquest, the end of Head Games could foreshadow an attempt to duplicate them using the Super-Adaptoid, though we can't imagine that going well. What's more interesting in this case is the reverse effect. The fact that Marvel programming is now introducing new characters to Marvel Comics. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Looper videos about MODOK are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.